Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And Mars has transited to Scorpio some time back, and for the next 3 weeks till 7th February 2020, it is going to be in Scorpio. Well, I thought I will not make a video on this, but it seems I should make a video on this because there are so many things which I have noticed in the recent 3 weeks, I would say, which has made the transit of Mars very important for everybody. All right, so this is a very crucial transit, not because it is transiting in Scorpio, because after 7th it is going to be conjunct with Ketu and Jupiter. So therefore it's like preparing the final ground before. All right, so we will discuss this transit in short today. And as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation, my website is down in the description section. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. So what is Mars? Mars is everything which is red. Which means Mars represents the... When Mars is well placed, it represents dedication. It represents discipline, determination, self-control, brahmacharya, celibacy, you know, willpower, all these things. When Mars is well placed, when Mars is not well placed, which means if it is afflicted, especially with Rahu or Saturn, then it can represent anger, frustration, jealousy, and at times even weird behavior I have seen, depending on the planets with who he is conjunct. All right, so now what's the point with Mars in Scorpio? Mars in Scorpio, what is Scorpio? Scorpio is originally the 8th house in the zodiac. We all know Scorpio is number 8. So therefore, Scorpio is ruled by Mars himself, but Scorpio is also ruled by Ketu. So that which distinguishes Mars and Scorpio and Aries is Ketu. Ketu has nothing to do with Aries, but Ketu has a lot to do with Scorpio. In fact, Ketu also has a lot of things to do with Aries, but not directly. That's at a subtle level, because the first nakshatra inside Ketu is Ashwini, which is ruled by Ketu again. So therefore, when it comes to Scorpio, Ketu has to do with at a physical level, and when it's Aries, Ketu has to do at a subtle level. Okay, so therefore now Mars has entered his own sign long time back. It's 15 degrees, so almost 3 weeks back Mars had entered, and now he is going to be there for the next 3 weeks. So what does it mean? See, Mars takes almost 2 years to complete the zodiac, all the 12 signs. So now Mars, 3 weeks back, had returned to his original house, his own house, after 3 weeks, almost after 2 years. You know, it's like a very long period. So what happens, you know, when you come home after a long time, what happens? You feel as if finally you are doing that which you should do. Should I repeat? You are doing that which you should do. Maybe sleep or eat or just hang out with your family and friends. So what does this mean? This means that the houses which Mars rules, depending on your ascendant, those houses can now finally give you some level of clarity that yes, these are your limitations, these are your strengths, and this is where you lie, somewhere in between. So you know your strengths and your weaknesses, and now it's good if you make a decision regarding the houses that Mars rules in your chart, depending on your ascendant, of what to do regarding those houses. Why do I say this? Because now, for the next 3 weeks, till 6th, 7th February, it will be in Scorpio, and it is going to enter Jyeshtha Nakshatra. Currently, Mars, yes, so it is going to enter Jyeshtha Nakshatra very soon. And currently Mars is transiting in Anuradha Nakshatra. It's in 14 degrees. And therefore, once it enters Jyeshtha Nakshatra. So when Mars is entering Anuradha, so currently what you could feel is, so today, today's date is 16th January. So it will be entering Jyeshtha after some time. All right, but we could also discuss about Anuradha. Oh, it's 4th pada almost, you know, so not much scope for Anuradha. But maybe by the time I upload this video, it would have entered Jyeshtha. So when Mars was in Anuradha or is in Anuradha, what you would have felt that, see, Anuradha is the nakshatra of submitting, basically. Anuradha says that it is important for you to be devoted to one cause. It seems as if it's difficult, but it's the easy way out, actually. Yes. So when Mars transited Anuradha, you would have realized that there were so many options which you had when Mars entered Swati. Then in Vishakha, you narrowed down the options, but there was still a confusion. But the moment Mars had entered Anuradha, you got some clarity that, yes, this is my path. This is what I should stick to. I should not try to put my head outside of the window all the time. All right. But that doesn't solve the problem. That is just the beginning of realizing that there can be a solution, or there could be a solution, or there needs to be a solution. And what that solution is, that will depend on your horoscope and the dashas that you are running. But when Mars enters Jyeshtha Nakshatra, you will get a feeling that now it is high time that I try to follow what gave me inspiration. So during Anuradha, we get used to seeing certain things in a way which makes us inspired from within to follow a certain path. And when Jyeshtha comes, we actually follow that path. So now is the time that we make a commitment towards ourselves and towards that person. You know, if Mars is your third lord, then your siblings or anything to do with travel, fourth lord, then it can be your mother or your home, fifth lord, children, anybody they can be. So we need to make a commitment towards them regarding the areas where we have, you know, intersections, basically. And that will really help us to realize that one day we have to settle down with certain things in life. The mind sometimes tells us that we will achieve everything in life. Everything is possible in life, but that's unfortunately not. And luckily, that is not possible. Why do I say luckily? Because imagine I tell you, there are 10 different types of ice creams. You need to choose from one of them. And then you will go and see, oh, there's vanilla, there's chocolate, there's strawberry, or whatever. But suppose now I tell you there are 1,000 types of ice creams. And imagine there is a store where there are 1,000 varieties of ice cream, but you can only choose one. Anuradha is that one. It is that one that you decide. One. That shows pinpointed focus, actually. So any intelligent person would say, no, I would prefer to choose from one of the 10 because it is easier for me to choose. Because that is what Mars also likes, because Mars represents Brahmacharya. And that is why if you visit ashrams where you will see Brahmacharis and Sannyasis, you know, everything is very pinpointed. You will not see, you know, there are colorful beds, or there are there are too many clothes loitering here and there. You will see, oh, they are wearing saffron, or some are wearing white. It's like it's very particular, and it's very clear what they are wearing, what they are doing. You won't see them hanging around just doing anything, all right, if they are genuine, of course. So therefore, Anuradha is that one thing which you must do to become happy, all right? But now suppose you decided which ice cream to take, and then now what? You start taking the ice cream, then you pay. So then Jyeshtha Nakshatra comes into picture. Jyeshtha Nakshatra is signified by Indra. Okay, Indra is a very important personality when it comes to Jyeshtha Nakshatra. So therefore, whenever it comes to Jyeshtha, you will always see that you have to pay the price for Anuradha, which means just being devoted to something mentally does not help. You also have to work towards it. You have to work to maintain, as Lord Krishna says in the Gita, Mana Shasthani Indriyani Prakriti Sthani Karshati. That to maintain oneself, the living entity is working very hard, day and night, foaming in the mouth. Right? So, and when you are doing your duty, you should always keep in mind the words of the scriptures, and especially the great personalities like Dhruva Maharaj, who is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And then we have Yudhishthira Maharaj, we have Arjuna, perfect personalities from whom to take inspiration. Then we just had Makar Sankranti, you know. I made a video on Bhishma Dev and many people liked it. Many people also said that it was such an emotional video that they were literally feeling that Bhishma Dev was, you know, passing away. They said that they felt as if they were standing in front and Bhishma Dev was passing away, and they became very emotional. And some people also messaged me that they were feeling as if they were crying after seeing that video. So that shows how well you could connect to Bhishma Dev and his teaching. So I'm very glad that anything of that sort would happen after seeing the video. So these personalities, they are perfect examples of how to be devoted to our goals, how to be devoted to our paths. Different paths are there, but how to be devoted to that one path, unflinching, as Krishna says in the Gita, Eke Hakuru Nandana, which means one pointed attention. Yes, and when we are realized, when we have knowledge regarding the areas of the scriptures, then we know actually how to be focused towards our goal. Because Krishna also says in the Gita, Nasa Siddhim Mavapanoti Nasukham Na Param Gatim. Kama Ista Ista Rita Jnana Vartate Kama Karataha. In that shloka, Krishna says, you know, one who derides the word of the scriptures does not attain peace in this life or in the next. So therefore, just searching in Google of regarding what to do, or just talking to some senior or your father or your mother or your sister or your brother or your best friend is not the solution every time. That is a solution at a temporary level, but the most important thing in life is to be aware and acknowledge the presence of these great personalities and take inspiration from them and guidance from them. Well, how can you do that? You may say, oh, Yudhishthira Maharaj is not here, Dhruva Maharaj is not here with us. No, they are always there. They are always there in the pages of the Srimad Bhagavatam. They are always there. They were, they are, and they will always be there for eternity. Yes, they are there in the Mahabharata, in the Ramayana, they are there. So although we know Hanumanji is, we can't see him, we can't feel his presence, but you will always see when you read the Ramayana, you will always, immediately you will feel Hanumanji's presence. And if you read about Lord Ram, that's what one of my gurus used to say, that whenever, you know, he always feels that whenever he is walking, you know, the Sudarshan Chakra is protecting him from the top. He always feels like that. Now, of course, some skeptic may say, oh, what nonsense is this? You know, oh, I don't see any chakra protecting him. Maybe that's an umbrella or something which he's holding with his hand. No, that a skeptic cannot understand, because that skeptic does not have the necessary humility and surrender, as Krishna says in the Gita, Tadvidhi pranipate na pari prasnena se bhaya. Upadekchantite jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinaha tadviddhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Means you should first humbly inquire, first you should offer service, and then you should inquire. Tadviddhi pranipatena pariprasnena, first you do pranipat and then pariprasnena sevaya, and then we understand what we should do and what we should not do. And sometimes People think that whenever we attend some spiritual discourses or any satsang program, we are not allowed to ask questions. We should just accept whatever the person is saying. No, it's not like that. I am not like that. I have always been asking thousands of questions to my gurus, always. Even now I keep asking. But there's a difference between asking a question and arguing with someone, right? And this is one of the symptoms of a good Mars. When Mars is well placed, you can ask a good question. But when Mars is not well placed, if Mars is weak, then you don't feel like asking a question. You are too much concerned what will people think. But if Mars is afflicted, then what happens? You ask questions in a mood, with a mood of, you know, arguing or judging or trying to prove that that person is not having the right answer. You purposefully ask these kind of questions. So there was one person, he once met one great sadhu. And this sadhu had come to his home. And then this person was very respectful in the beginning. But then this this crooked person, what he did, he said to the sadhu that, oh, your guru has sent you to me to enlighten me regarding certain areas. But I have certain conditions, you know, I will only listen to you if you do what I tell you to do. And then this this sadhu told him, okay, so what do you want me to do? If it is within the periphery of the scriptures, I will do it. If it is outside, I will not do it. So then this crooked gentleman, this gentleman told him that you have to take cold drinks, you know, Fanta. And then this sadhu said, no, I don't take cold drinks, but okay, that doesn't have alcohol, so because of you, I can take it. And then he took the glass of Fanta and he drank it. And then this person again filled the glass. And he said, okay, so now you have to take this glass and put it over your head. You know? Just one full glass of Fanta. And then he said, okay, that is what you want me to do. I will do it. He took the glass and he just poured it all over his head, and his, you know, body was drenched in this cold drink. And then this sadhu was totally disgusted. He said, that's it. I'm leaving. I will not stay here. And then this person says, oh, you're a sadhu. How can a sadhu get angry? You know, sadhus are not supposed to be angry. You know, sadhus are supposed to be tolerant. And then this sadhu told him, because my guru had instructed me to come and speak some spiritual topics here, that is why I was sitting here from so long. And if my guru would have not sent me here, your head would have been chopped off, and I can still do that, but I will not do that. Because I came here because of my guru's instruction. So now you have crossed the limits. I am leaving. And of course, I will not tell what happened to that this crooked gentleman later on. His karma took care of the rest. All right. So that is why it is essential that whatever decisions we make in life, we ground ourselves with the word of the rishis and the scriptures. Otherwise, even if you make the right decisions, they will not give us fulfillment in the long run. All right. So when Mars enters Jyeshtha, you will feel that now there is a need to make a commitment regarding the areas which Mars rules in the chart. And now is the time that you finally make the commitment and stay committed to that one path which you decided when Mars had entered Anuradha. And when finally Mars enters Mula after 7 February 2020, and after 7 February you will start seeing the results, all right? Because Mula Nakshatra will uproot and plan the things. So if you are not dedicated to your path, Mars will uproot whatever you have. And if you are dedicated, then Mars will uproot everything else and plant the seeds. All right. So thank you very much for your patience. Make the right decisions and be dedicated to one single path. All right. Thank you very much. And if you're new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation, you can find my website down in the description section. Okay, what is there with you? All the time, just look to him and you will find him.